Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Beginner's Guide to Constructing the Universe, Mathematical Archetypes of Nature, Art, and Science, by Michael S. Schneider, narrated by Al Kessel. Publisher's Note: This audiobook refers to illustrations, diagrams, and pictures included in the print and ebook editions of the book. A universal beauty showed its face, the invisible, deep-fraught significances. Here, sheltered behind form's insensible screen, uncovered to him their deathless harmony, and the key to the wonder book of common things. In their uniting law stood up revealed the multiple measures of the uplifting force, the lines of the world geometer's technique, the enhancements that uphold the cosmic web, and the magic underlying simple shapes. Sri Aurobindo Ghosh, 1872-1950, Indian spiritual guide, poet. Number is the within of all things, attributed to Pythagoras, circa 580-500 BC, Greek philosopher and mathematician. The earth is rude, silent, incomprehensible at first. Nature is incomprehensible at first. Be not discouraged, keep on. There are divine things well enveloped. I swear to you, there are divine beings more beautiful than words can tell. Walt Whitman, 1819-1892, American poet. Education is the instruction of the intellect in the laws of nature, under which name I include not merely things and their forces, but men and their ways, and the fashioning of the affections and of the will into an earnest and loving desire to move in harmony with those laws. Thomas Henry Huxley, 1825-1895, English biologist. Geometry and the Quest for Reality, by John Mitchell. Sooner or later, there comes a time in life when you start thinking about reality and where to find it. Some people tell you there is no such thing, that the world has nothing permanent in it, and, as far as you are concerned, consists merely of your fleeting experiences. Its framework, they say, is the random product of a natural process, meaningless and undirected. Others believe that the world was made by a divine creator who continues to guide its development. This sounds a more interesting idea, but as skeptics point out, every religion and church that upholds it does so by faith alone. If you are naturally faithful and can accept without question the orthodoxy of your particular religion or system of beliefs, you will feel no need to inquire further, and this book will appear superfluous. It was written for those of us who lack or have lost the gift of simple faith, who need evidence for our beliefs. We cannot help being attracted by the religious view that the world is a harmonious, divinely ordered creation in which, as Plato promised the uninitiated, things are taken care of far better than you could possibly believe. Yet superficially, it is a place of confusion and chaos, where suffering is constant and the ungodly flourish. This is where we begin the quest for reality. Looking closely at nature, the first insight we obtain is that, behind the apparently endless proliferation of natural objects, there is a far lesser number of apparently fixed types. We see, for example, that through every generation, cats are cats and are programmed for cat-like behavior. In the same way, every rose has the unique characteristics of a rose, and every oak leaf is definitely an oak leaf. No two specimens of these are exactly the same, but each one is clearly a product of its formative type. If it were not so, if plants and animals simply inherited their progenitors' characteristics, the order of nature would soon dissolve into an infinite variety of creatures, undifferentiated by species and kinships. This observation, of one type with innumerable products, gives rise to the old philosophical problem of the one and the many. The problem is that, whereas the many are visible and tangible and can be examined at leisure, the one is never seen or sensed, and its very existence is only inferred through the evident effect it has upon its products, the many. Yet, paradoxically, the one is more truly real than the many. In the visible world of nature, all is flux. Everything is either being born or dying, or moving between the two processes. Nothing ever achieves the goal of perfection or the state of equilibrium that would allow it to be described in essence. The phenomena of nature, said Plato, are always becoming, never actually are. Our five senses tell us that they are real, but the intellect judges differently, reasoning that the one, which is constant, creative, and ever the same, is more entitled to be called real than its ever-fluctuating products. The search for reality leads us inevitably toward the type, the enigmatic one that lies behind the obvious world of the many. Immediately we encounter difficulties. Being imperceptible and existing only as abstractions, types cannot be apprehended by the methods of physical science. A number of modern scientists, perceiving the influence of types in nature, have attempted to bring them within the range of empirical study. Rupert Sheldrake, author of A New Science of Life and other works, has taken a bold step in that direction. In an earlier age, the Pythagoreans worked on systematizing the types by means of numerical formulae. Yet Plato, who wrote at length on the subject of constant types, referred to as forms, was carefully ambiguous in defining them and never made clear the means by which they influence the world of appearances. Plato did, however, give instructions on the procedure toward understanding the nature and function of the types. In the Republic, he described the ascent of the mind through four different stages. It begins in ignorance, when it does not even know that there is anything worth knowing. The next stage is opinion, the stage in which TV chat show participants are forever stuck. This is divided into two subcategories, right opinion and wrong opinion. Above that is the level of reason. By education and study, particularly in certain mind-sharpening subjects, the candidate is prepared for entry into the fourth stage, which is called intelligence, nous. One can be prepared for it, but with no guarantee of success, for it is a level that one can only achieve on one's own, the level of heightened or true understanding, which is the mental level of an initiate. The studies that Plato specified as most effective in preparing the mind for understanding are the so-called mathematical subjects, consisting of number itself, music, geometry, and astronomy. These were the main studies of Pythagoras and his followers, who anticipated the realization of modern physics in proclaiming that all scales and departments of nature were linked by the same code of number. Geometry is the purest visible expression of number. In Platonic terms, the effect of its study is to lead the mind upward from opinion onto the level of reason, where its premises are rooted. It then provides the bridge or ladder by which the mind can achieve its highest level in the realm of pure intelligence. Geometry is also the bridge between the one and the many. When you draw one of its basic figures, a circle, say, or a triangle or regular polygon, you do not copy someone else's drawing. Your model is the abstract ideal of a circle or triangle. It is the perfect form, the unchanging, unmanifest one. Below it are the many, the expressions of that figure in design, art, and architecture. In nature, also the one circle gives rise to the many, in the shapes and orbits of the planets, in the roundness of berries, nests, eyeballs, and the cycles of time. On every scale, every natural pattern of growth or movement conforms inevitably to one or more of the simple geometric types. The Pentagon, for example, lies behind each specimen of the five-petaled rose, the five-fingered starfish, and many other living forms, whereas the sixfold, hexagonal type, as seen in the structure of snowflakes and crystal generally, pertains typically to inanimate nature. As soon as you enter upon the world of sacred, symbolic, or philosophical geometry, from your first thoughtful construction of a circle with the circumference divided into its natural six parts, your mind is opened to new influences that stimulate and refine it. You begin to see, as never before, the wonderfully patterned beauty of creation. You see true artistry, far and above any human contrivance. This indeed is the very source of art. By contact with it, your aesthetic senses are heightened and set upon the firm basis of truth. Beyond the obvious pleasure of contemplating the works of nature, the many, is the delight that comes through the philosophical study of geometry, of moving toward the presence of the One. Michael Schneider is an experienced teacher and, as you are entitled to expect, a master of his geometric craft. No one less qualified could set out its basic principles so clearly and simply. His much rarer asset is appreciation of the symbolic and cosmological symbolism inherent in geometry. That is the best reason for being interested in the subject, and it is the reason why the philosophers of ancient Greece, Egypt, and other civilizations made geometry and number the most important of their studies. The traditional science taught in their mystery schools is hardly known today. It is not available for study in any modern place of education, and there is very little writing on the subject. In this book, you will find something that cannot be obtained elsewhere, a complete introduction to the geometric code of nature, written and illustrated by the most perceptive of its modern investigators. Introduction. Fanning ancient sparks. The universe may be a mystery, but it's not a secret. Each of us is capable of comprehending much more than we might realize. A vision of mathematics different from that which we were taught at school holds an accessible key to a nearby world of wonder and beauty. The most incomprehensible thing about the universe is that it is comprehensible. Albert Einstein, 1879 through 1955. In ancient Greece, the advanced students of the philosopher Pythagoras, who were engaged in deep studies of natural science and self-understanding, were called mathematikoi, those who studied all. The word mathema signified learning in general and was the root of the Old English mathein, to be aware, and the Old German munden, to awaken. Today, the word math has, for most people, constricted its scope to emphasize mundane measurement and mere manipulation of quantities. We've unwittingly traded wide-ranging vision for narrow expertise. It's a shame that children are exposed to numbers merely as quantities, instead of qualities and characters with distinct personalities relating to each other in various patterns. If only they could see numbers and shapes as the ancients did, as symbols of principles available to teach us about the natural structure and processes of the universe, and to give us perspective on human nature. Instead, math education for children demands rote memorization of procedures to get one right answer and pass innumerable skill tests to prove superficial mastery before moving on to the next isolated topic. Teachers call this the drill and kill method. Even its terminology informs us that this approach to math is full of problems. It's no wonder countless people are innumerate. We've lost sight of the spiritual qualities of number and shape by emphasizing brute quantity. Nothing in education is so astonishing as the amount of ignorance it accumulates in the form of inert facts. Henry Brooks Adams, 1838-1918, American historian. This book concerns mathematics, but not the kind you were shown at school. Bodily exercise, when compulsory, does no harm to the body, but knowledge which is acquired under compulsion obtains no hold on the mind. Plato, circa 428-348 BC, Greek mathematical philosopher. The Roman goddess Numeria is said to have assisted in teaching each child to count. We must have a misunderstanding because I grew up on uneasy terms with the subject of mathematics in school. I was intrigued by the infinity of numbers and could calculate mechanically if I had memorized the rule I was taught for a given situation. Although I liked science and art, math intimidated me. I remember my frustrated tears at age 7 over the concept of subtracting by borrowing from another column when it contained a zero. I dreaded math, its mindless memorization, and its tedious paperwork. Pity the teachers who have to check it. Math was dry and mechanical and had little relevance to my world. If we had looked at numbers to see how they behave with each other in wonderful patterns, I might have liked math. Had I been shown how numbers and shapes relate to the world of nature, I would have been thrilled. Instead, I was dulled by math anxiety and pop quizzes. Fortunately for me, when I was 16, one of my teachers mentioned that mathematics can be found in nature. A six-sided snowflake is shaped like a bee cell and quartz crystal. I was stunned to make the connection. How could something as apparently irrelevant as mathematics be related to something as wonderful as nature? The ordinary world opened up to me and spoke the language of number and shape. No longer a foe, the dreaded mathematics became at once a teacher and a tool. Nature wasn't what it was made out to be, an antagonist to fear, conquer, and exploit, but a garden of wonder and a patient teacher worthy of great respect. Over the years, my studies led me to see that a profound understanding of numbers was prevalent in ancient times, more than is commonly acknowledged, and seamlessly wove mathematics, philosophy, art, religion, myth, nature, science, technology, and everyday life. This book is a fanning of some little sparks of philosophy from deep antiquity to introduce the general reader to another view of mathematics, nature, and ourselves that is our heritage and birthright. It requires that we liberate math from its pigeonhole and see it spanning the framework of the most interdisciplinary topic possible, the universe. Plato wrote that all knowledge is already deep within us, so no one can really teach us anything new. But we can remind each other of the archetypal principles of number and nature we already know but may have forgotten. This book is intended as that reminder to guide you through this world of wisdom, beauty, uplift, and delight, and to remind you of the gentle, wise principles by which the universe is designed. Wisdom should be cherished as a means of traveling from youth to old age, for it is more lasting than any other possession. Bias of Priene, circa 570 BC, one of the seven sages of ancient Greece. By them, the Greeks, geometry was held in the very highest honor, and none were more illustrious than mathematicians. But we, Romans, have limited the practice of this art to its usefulness in measurement and calculation. Cicero, 106 to 43 BC, Roman orator, statesman, and philosopher. Three levels of mathematics. Mathematics is whole, but it may be divided into three levels or approaches: secular, symbolic, and sacred. Secular mathematics. What is taught in school can be called secular mathematics. Adding the amounts of a store purchase, calculating change, weighing produce, measuring ingredients for a recipe, counting votes, telling time, designing a bookshelf or skyscraper, measuring land boundaries, stock market economics, calculating tax. We're taught these are the ends of mathematics for non-scientists. We train children to be human pocket calculators. Even many educated people who are adept at calculating have no idea that there is more to mathematics than mere reckoning of quantities. This quantitative approach keeps us dull to the potential wisdom that the familiar counting numbers can teach us. When imaginatively taught to people beginning at an early age, mathematics can delight, inspire, and refine us. It can make us aware of the patterns with which the world and we are made. Instead, math is taught as a servant of commerce, without regard for its basis in nature. It is viewed as a distant subject that instills much more anxiety than wonder and inspiration. Mathematics is seen as outside us to be occasionally called upon, rather than woven into the fiber of our existence. Nature, that universal and public manuscript. Sir Thomas Brown, 1605 to 1682, English physician and author. Symbolic mathematics. Embedded in the very structure of ordinary numbers is another level, which may be called symbolic or philosophical mathematics. It is well known that simple numbers and shapes relate to each other in harmonious recurring patterns. Just notice how floor tiles containing different shapes mesh. Mathematicians and scientists seek and study patterns as clues to a deeper understanding of the universe. What's more, symbolic mathematics recognizes numbers and shape patterns as representative of far-reaching principles. They can be guides to a deep cosmic canon of design. Nature itself rests on an internal foundation of archetypal principles symbolized by numbers, shapes, and their arithmetic and geometric relationships. Nature is written in symbols and signs. John Greenleaf Whittier, 1807 to 1892, American poet. According to ancient mathematical philosophers, the simple counting numbers from 1 to 10 and the shapes that represent them, such as circle, line, triangle, and square, express a consistent, comprehensible language. The 10 numbers are a complete archetypal source book. They are the original 10 patents for designs found all through the universe. These ideal patterns are the ones that we skewed and veiled in school, and that nature approximates in all transitory forms, from the smallest subatomic particles to the largest galactic clusters, crystals, plants, fruits and vegetables, weather patterns, and animal and human bodies. Anything anyone can point to in nature is composed of small patterns and is a part of larger ones. All things are full of signs, and it is a wise man who can learn about one thing from another. Plotinus, 205 to 270, Roman Neoplatonic philosopher. I am not ambitious to appear a man of letters. I could be content the world should think I had scarce looked upon any other book than that of nature. Robert Boyle, 1627 to 1691, British physicist and chemist. In nature's infinite book of secrecy, a little I can read. William Shakespeare, 1564 to 1616. Living in the world without insight into the hidden laws of nature is like not knowing the language of the country in which one was born. Hazrat Inayat Khan, 1882 to 1927, Sufi spiritual guide, musician, and writer. Historically, nature has been compared to a book written in geometric characters. In 1611, Galileo wrote, "Philosophy is written in this grand book, I mean the universe, which stands continually open to our gaze, but it cannot be understood unless one first learns to comprehend the language and interpret the characters in which it is written. It is written in the language of mathematics, and its characters are triangles, circles, and other geometric figures, without which it is humanly impossible to understand a single word of it. Without these, one is wandering about in a dark labyrinth." Reading the Book of Nature first requires familiarity with its alphabet and geometric glyphs. We're exposed to nature's text in the natural shapes around us, but we don't recognize it as something we can read. Identifying shapes and patterns and knowing what principles they represent allow us to understand what nature is doing in any given situation and why these principles are applied in human affairs. Why are plates and pipes and planets round? Why do hurricanes and hair curls, atoms and pine cones unfurl as spirals? Why didn't school teach us that when we see the same spiral shape in shells, galaxies, and watery whirlpools, we are witnessing the principle of balance through motion? Or that the hexagonal cells of beehives package the maximum space using the least materials, energy, and time? Nature labels everything with a cosmic calligraphy, but we generally don't suspect even the existence of the language. It is an open secret, fully in view, but usually unnoticed. Like constants and vowels, like building blocks and growth patterns, numbers, shapes, and their patterns symbolize omnipresent principles, including wholeness, polarity, structure, balance, cycles, rhythm, and harmony. Each shape represents a different problem-solving strategy in the cosmic economy. To see more deeply into this design alphabet, we must be conversant in nature's native tongue, the language of symbolic mathematics. This book is primarily concerned with symbolic mathematics. For the nature of number is to be informative, guiding, and instructive for anybody in everything that is subject to doubt and that is unknown. For nothing about things would be comprehensible to anybody, neither of things in themselves, nor of one in relation to the other, if number and its essence were non-existent. The essence of number, like harmony, does not allow misunderstanding, for this is strange to it. Deception and envy are inherent to the unbounded, unknowable, and unreasonable. Truth, however, is inherent in the nature of number and inbred in it. Philolaus, 5th century BC, Greek Pythagorean philosopher. Sacred mathematics. The terms sacred sites, sacred geography, sacred architecture, sacred arithmetic, and sacred geometry seem overused today. To the ancients, the sacred had a particular significance involving consciousness and the profound mystery of awareness. How are you and I aware of these very words and their significance? Now that you've heard them, these words are no longer just on a page. They're within your awareness. Sacred space is within us, not in our body or brain cells, but in the volume of our consciousness. Wherever we go, we bring the sacred within us to the sacred around us. We consecrate locations and studies by the presence of this awareness, not just the other way around. Why should the sites of stone temples and wonderful cathedrals be more sacred than a rocky desert or concrete city street if we bring holy consciousness to each of them? Geographic locations are no more or less sacred than any other, although they may be powerful telluric sites. Awareness is the ultimate sacred wonder. Why endow objects outside ourselves as sacred and ignore the same source within us? A surprising amount of the world's religious art and architecture has been designed using the timeless symbolic patterns of nature and number. But these patterns remain symbolic of our own sacred inner realm, symbolic of the subtle structure of awareness whose source is the same as archetypal number. All this was understood in ancient times and deemed so important that it was built into the culture on every level. "You amuse me," I said, "with your obvious fear that the public will disapprove if the subjects you prescribe don't seem useful. But it is, in fact, no easy matter, but very difficult for people to believe that there is a faculty in the mind of each of us which these studies purify and rekindle after it has been ruined and blinded by other pursuits, though it is more worth preserving than an eye, since it is the only organ by which we perceive the truth. Those who agree with us about this will give your proposals unqualified approval, but those who are quite unaware of it will probably think you are talking nonsense, as they won't see what other benefit is to be expected from such studies. Modern science tells us what we commonly call reality is a compilation of pictures based on a narrow sense band view of surface features. The world we perceive is a small slice of a vast, mostly invisible energy event. Mathematics can take us beyond our ordinary limits to the cosmic depths. Plato, at his academy, required the study of mathematics as a prerequisite for philosophia, a term signifying the love of wisdom and to lift the soul to truth. Just over a century earlier, Pythagoras had invented the word philosophy as a result of a question posed to him. When asked, "Are you wise?" he is said to have answered, "No, but I am a lover of wisdom." Both Pythagoras and Plato suggested that all citizens learn the properties of the first 10 numbers as a form of moral instruction. The study and contemplation of number and geometry can show us, if we look with the eyes of ancient mathematical philosophers, that neither outer nature nor human nature is the hodgepodge it may seem. Symbolic mathematics provides a map of our own inner psychological and sacred spiritual structure. But studying number properties and intellectually knowing the roadmap, the symbolism, is not the same as actually taking the journey. We take that journey by finding within ourselves the universal principles these properties represent and by applying the knowledge to our own growth. We pay attention to paying attention, in imageless awareness, directing sustained attention to that which the symbols refer to within us. When the lessons of symbolic or philosophical mathematics seen in nature, which were designed into religious architecture or art, are applied functionally, not just intellectually, to facilitate the growth and transformation of consciousness, then mathematics may rightly be called sacred. To me, the terms sacred arithmetic and sacred geometry only have significance when grounded in the experience of self-awareness. Religious art is sacred not only due to its subject matter, but also because it was designed using the subtle symbolic language of number, shape, and proportion to teach self-understanding and functional self-development. Ancient Egyptian arts, crafts, and architecture perhaps provide the best accessible examples of design that use the symbolism of number, geometry, and nature to teach an accelerated form of self-development to trained initiates who knew how to translate the symbolism into meditative exercises. The real mystery of life is not a problem to be solved. It is a reality to be experienced. J.J. Vanderloo. Thus, true sacred geometry cannot be taught through books, but must remain as part of the ancient oral tradition passed from teacher to pupil, mouth to ear. Because over centuries this knowledge was passed along secretly so as not to conflict with the prevailing intolerant religious authorities or be disposed to those considered profane, there is still an aura of mysticism about it. But nature's patterns and those of our inner life are familiar to everyone and always available to us. The power which we seek is the power with which we seek. When we feel separate from the archetypes of nature, number, and shape, we make them mystical, but this only keeps ourselves in a mist. There is no need for secrecy and occultism any longer. These are everyone's life facts. We can apply them to better appreciate the world and will need them once we realize the urgency of cooperating with the way the world works. This book is concerned with dispelling the mysticism surrounding sacred mathematics by reintegrating the timeless knowledge of number and shape with its familiar expressions in nature, art, and its practical significance for self-development. The goal of life is living in agreement with nature. Zeno of Elea, 490-430 BC, Greek philosopher. Studying, contemplating, and living in agreement with universal principles is a social responsibility and can be a spiritual path. It is becoming clear that when we cooperate with nature's ways, we succeed. When we resist, we struggle. Implications for our environmental crises are obvious. Rather than an antagonist, nature can be our teacher to learn from and cooperate with to mutual benefit. To understand nature better, we first need to recognize the roles of its basic patterns. We are born for cooperation. Marcus Aurelius, 121-180, philosopher at 12, Roman emperor at 40. Mathematics, math as creation myth. To say that ancient seers viewed the universe and themselves in a way different from ours is an understatement. Today, we are emerging from the grip of literalism, mere quantitative measurement, and analysis. The ancients had a more poetic and synthesizing vision. We think we invented math, but the ancients knew that they were involved in a process of discovery. They personified in stories the forces of nature and gave them names of gods, goddesses, and nature spirits. Mythological exploits helped explain the origins and ways of familiar events from world creation to night and day, storms, agriculture, wars, love, hate, joy, sleep, life and death, and the full spectrum of natural and human affairs. But today we condescend and say that's how, in their childlike way, those pagans attempted to explain the mysteries of the world while lacking our enlightened scientific understanding. We think we really understand the forces of nature because we have labels, theories, terminology, experiments, measurements, advanced formulas, and astounding technological tools. With our habit of sensible literalism, we have a difficult time believing that the ancient mythopoeic imagination could have been a valid tool for serious knowledge. Yet it is we who have the cruder understanding. By pigeonholing fragmented facts, we miss the whole harmonious picture. We grope in a world we consider dangerous, accidental, and chaotic, but one that is actually harmonious and awaiting our cooperation. If only we could see with the eyes of the ancients. Scientists confirm with formulas what ancient seers knew through revelation, that the world's patterns and cycles are harmonious when seen as mathematical relationships. The ancients' intuitive revelations were grounded by the study of nature, numbers, and shapes. The ancient Greeks were particularly interested in the ways geometric shapes mesh in recurring harmonious patterns. The Greek word harmonia signifies fitting together, as we see in floor tiles, quilts, and wallpaper patterns, and how forces of nature orchestrate in small and large cycles, as satellites now reveal one worldwide weather pattern. Where we see things, nouns, and discrete objects, the ancient mathematical philosophers saw processes, verbs, transforming patterns meshed harmoniously. In truth, the buck never stops. The Hopi language retains this vision, having no nouns. I'm not wearing a shirt, but I'm shirting. Likewise, our word cosmos generally refers to outer space. But the word derives from the Greek kosmos, signifying embroidery, which implied not a universe like a huge room filled with disconnected noun things, but the orderliness and harmony of woven patterns with which the universe is embroidered and moves. Cosmos signified the honorable and right behavior of the whole, the harmonious orchestration of the world's patterns and processes. In this original sense, our word cosmetics refers not to the nouns involved, the lipstick and rouge, but to the process of bringing the elements of the face into harmony. By studying the recurring harmonious patterns inherent in mathematics, music, and nature, ancient mathematical philosophers recognized that consistent correspondences occur throughout the universe. The Greeks investigated arithmetic by arranging pebbles in various geometric shapes, figurate arithmetic, and so uncovered the archetypal patterns and principles inherent in many types of relationships. This study developed over centuries from what we call number magic to become the modern branch of mathematics called number theory. Through extensive study of patterns and by intuitive revelation, the ancients realized that the structure and patterns of arithmetic and geometry reenact the creating processes found all through nature. In both number and nature, they saw the same divine impress. Strip away all the sensory characteristics of color, texture, tone, taste, and smell from an object, and only number remains as its size, weight, and quantity. Take away the features associated with number, and it's all gone. Ordinary numbers and shapes represent eternal verities in a form made comprehensible to us. Mathematics is a philosophical language that reveals the Greek archai, the foundation principles of universal design and construction. Numerals, the written symbols of non-tangible numbers, and geometric shapes are the emblems of these archetypal principles. The archetypes are universal in that they are the same to everyone everywhere and in every era. Our biggest failure is our failure to see patterns. Marilyn Ferguson, American writer. the harmony of the world is made manifest in form and number, and the heart and soul and all the poetry of natural philosophy are embodied in the concept of mathematical beauty. Sir Darcy Wentworth Thompson, 1860 to 1948, Scottish zoologist, classical scholar. Nature's harmonious principles are exhibited through its mathematical relationships. As we learn to read its archetypal language, we discover that the topic of the Book of Nature is a story, a mythic quest about the process of transformation. This mathematical myth of the creative process, this mathematics, is not ancient or new age, but timeless, accessible in every age because it encodes eternal constants available to all. Although the myth's outer form adapts to different cultures, it may be rediscovered in any era by examining simple numbers, basic shapes, and ever-present nature. Thus, people of every historical period can understand the principles of nature's creating process by imaginatively examining the corresponding archetypal relationships inherent in mathematics, personified in mythology, and depicted in art and culture. This book is intended as a beginner's guide to the process of recovering that vision. The world, harmoniously confused, where order and variety we see, and where, though all things differ, all agree. Alexander Pope, 1688 to 1744, English poet. In the view of philosophical mathematicians, numbers and their associated shapes represent stages in the process of becoming. While integrated in the whole, each has a life of its own and a unique role in the cosmic myth. The archetypes of number and shape were personified in ancient cultures as various gods, goddesses, and world builders. The classic myths elaborated on particular aspects of the universal principles they represented. Their interrelationships and liaisons, which we consider a soap opera, transmitted timeless truths. Through state sanction, as in Egypt, Greece, India, Africa, China, Tibet, Native America, and elsewhere, all aspects of society were organized according to a canon consistent with nature's own structure. The proportions of temples were always designed, situated, and built in accord with the number and shape symbolism representing the temple's deity. Through the process known as gematria, which associates number values with letters of a carefully constructed alphabet, as in Greek, Hebrew, Arabic, Syriac, and Egyptian, the names, titles, and attributes of deities reveal, to those initiated to the code, their role in the cosmic constructive process. For example, 7 was known as the number of the Virgin, because no number below 7 enters into, divides it, nor does it reproduce another number within the first 10. Through gematria, the Greek letters of the name of the maiden goddess Athena add up to 77, giving us a standard for measuring length, distance. The letters of her epithet, Pallas, add to 343, which equals 7 times 7 times 7, indicating volume. The letters of her appellation, Parthenos, Virgin, add to 515. And it is no coincidence that 51.5 degrees is extremely close to the angle within a regular heptagon, the shape with 7 equal sides and angles, giving us area. Each deity represented a set of archetypal principles that were made comprehensible as mathematical patterns for practical use as length, area, volume, weight, duration, and music, and were applied to the architecture and ritual of the deity's temple precinct. Each deity was responsible for overseeing part of the world's harmonious structure, in the same way that his or her mathematical patterns did. Ancient mythology was consciously integrated with and symbolized by the universal and timeless canon of nature's mathematics. All the effects of nature are only the mathematical consequences of a small number of immutable laws. Pierre Simon de Laplace, 1749-1827, French astronomer and mathematician. To know all, it is necessary to know very little. But to know that very little, one must first know pretty much. George I. Gurdjieff, 1872-1949. Numbers are the highest degree of knowledge. It is knowledge itself. Plato. This book makes practical the teachings of the Pythagoreans and others, including Plato, Theon of Smyrna, Iamblichus, Philolaus, Proclus, and Nicomachus, concerning the numbers 1 to 10 as a complete frame for exploring and constructing the fundamental forms of the universe. These first 10 numbers are like seeds from which all subsequent numbers and shapes grow, sharing and expanding their properties. The use of Greek words for these number principles, monad, dyad, triad, and so on, as chapter titles, is intended for more than numerical order. These terms represent a process of unfolding cosmic qualities and principles. Each chapter is devoted to one number and shape principle. Although we count in sequence from 1 to 10, these number principles do not only unfold sequentially, but interpenetrate the universe simultaneously in a cosmic symphony. Man, though seeing, suffered from blindness, and for him, I found numbers, the purest of inventions. Aeschylus, 525-456 BC, Greek tragic dramatist. The cosmic creating process is deep within us and can emerge through our hands with the help of the three traditional tools of the geometer, the compass, the straight edge, and the pencil. To the ancients, these tools represented three divine attributes that designed the patterns of the world. Just in this century, modern science is rediscovering what the ancients symbolized by these three tools and their use. Albert Einstein referred to them as E equals mc squared, the famous relationship among the universe's three tools of the configurating process: light, energy, and mass, or matter. The roles and motions of the geometer's three tools in geometric construction replicate the universe's own creating process, whereby ideal patterns are approximated in natural design on all levels. We will look at our own constructions on paper as representing universal creations. Each step we take symbolizes a cosmic motion. By contemplating the essence of each of the 10 numbers through our geometric constructions, we will gaze directly at the lines on the face of deep wisdom, the divine substrate of nature and ourselves. Geometry is knowledge of the externally existent. Plato. He therefore who wishes to rejoice without doubt in regard to the truths underlying phenomena must know how to devote himself to experiment. Roger Bacon, 1220-1292, English philosopher and scientist. About this book. The best effect of any book is that it excites the reader to self-activity. Thomas Carlyle, 1795-1881, Scottish essayist and historian. Verifying number principles for ourselves is more important than just hearing about them. No matter how conversant we are with the details of any map or restaurant menu, it's more informative to take the journey and more nourishing to eat the food. We can discover for ourselves the timelessness of nature's creating process by consciously participating in geometric activities. If you do not rest upon the good foundation of nature, you will labor with little honor and less profit. Those who take for their standard any one but nature, the mistress of all masters, weary themselves in vain. Leonardo da Vinci, 1452-1519. By doing geometric constructions on paper or with a stick in the sand, we are recalling the ageless process of creation, replicating with our mind and hands the generative principles by which the universe is evolving. Our constructions will demonstrate to us the harmonious principles at work in the world. Symbolic and sacred mathematics encode subtle experiences whose purpose is different from that of secular mathematics. They can invigorate, refine, and elevate us. Our role as geometers is to discover the inherent proportion, balance, and harmony that exist in any situation. The study and experience of numeric and geometric proportion infuses in us an appreciation of proportion everywhere. The study of balance teaches us to recognize and seek a sense of balance in our lives. The study of harmony develops our sense of harmony in all relationships. Actually, to see and work with unity and wholeness in geometry and natural forms, rather than just read about them, can help abolish our false notion of separateness from nature and from each other. It is this notion that ultimately fuels competition for the goods of the earth and contributes to environmental crises. The material of this book, developed over years of study and through holding public workshops and courses for people of widely varying interests, especially artists, architects, and educators. When my interest in this subject first began, I was sure that someone must have written one book explaining to my satisfaction the relationship between numbers, shapes, nature, science, art, and self. The information seems so fundamental, and people have been around for so many millennia to view it, that I was surprised to learn it only exists in books, articles, and fragments written mostly for specialized interests. I couldn't find the one book I was looking for that tied it all together, so I wrote it. It seems that the best approach to show you what I've learned is to take you beyond listening and involve you in the already existing synthesis of geometry, natural science, art, and self-understanding through a hands-on approach. This book is intended to facilitate these studies in such a way as to see ourselves as part of the overall harmony and have the tools to engage in it. It will guide you to see how number and shape symbolism is already familiar to us through popular sayings, fairy tales, myths, and religious ritual. To examine the archetypal principles expressed by simple numbers and shapes, and to let you verify the natural relationships existing among them. You'll do this by following step-by-step instructions for recreating the basic geometric constructions symbolizing unfolding universal principles. You will use the tools of the geometer's creating process, the compass, straight edge, and pencil, to make two-dimensional and three-dimensional models of the principles expressed by the numbers from 1 to 10. To see where and understand why these numerical archetypes precipitate as organic and inorganic forms in nature and are the ones we rely upon in technology and engineering, you will be shown how to apply the geometric constructions to images of familiar natural forms, discovering for yourself the ways nature speaks her geometric language. To examine examples of art throughout the world that display mathematical design, by applying the same geometric constructions to reproductions of art in the book, using tracing paper, you will learn to see how archetypal mathematical principles have been purposefully and consistently applied, to a surprising degree, to art, jewelry, and architecture throughout the world, endowing them with powerful compositional structure, symbolic significance, and intended psychological effects. Some examples will show the geometry the artist used. Further examples are left for you to complete and explore based on the geometric constructions you have learned. The real voyage of discovery consists not in seeking new lands, but seeing with new eyes. Marcel Proust, 1871 to 1922, French novelist. This is not school, so doodling here at any time is okay, even encouraged. The word doodle signifies absent-minded scrawling and is related to dawdle, wasting time in inconsequential activity. Both words derive from the Low German doodledop, referring to a foolish or frivolous person. But Leonardo da Vinci and Dostoevsky were doodlers. Doodling is a valid tool for awakening geometric vision and self-exploration. Try using your opposite hand to make you aware of your doodles in a different way. Psychologists call doodles manifestations of the unconscious. Letting our pencil flow without conscious intellectual control allows the archetypal patterns from within us to emerge. It is a geometer's method for self-discovery. But don't just take my word for this. Try everything yourself. Keep as your own only what your experience validates. As legal residents of the cosmos, we have the authority to view the world's blueprints. Here they are. Construct the patterns that construct the universe. Come forth into the light of things. Let nature be your teacher. William Wordsworth, 1770 to 1850, English poet. Chapter 1. Monad Holy One. You cannot conceive the many without the one. The study of the unit is among those that lead the mind on and turn it to the vision of reality. Plato. One principle must make the universe a single complex living creature, one from all. Plotinus. Everything an Indian does is in a circle, and that is because the power of the world always works in circles, and everything tries to be round. Black Elk, 1863 to 1950. The eye is the first circle. The horizon which it forms is the second. And throughout nature, this primary figure is repeated without end. Ralph Waldo Emerson, 1803 to 1882. American essayist and poet. It is a fallacy of the old schools to divide man into parcels, elements, thoughts, emotions, intuitions, etc. All human faculties consist of an interconnected whole. Alfred Korzybski, 1879 to 1950, American semanticist. All are but parts of one stupendous whole. Alexander Pope. Whence shall he have grief? How shall he be deluded who sees everywhere the oneness? Isha Upanishad. The circle draws us. In the 14th century, Pope Benedictus XII was selecting artists to work for the Vatican, requesting from each applicant a sample of his ability. Although the Florentine painter Giotto, 1266 to 1337, was known as a master of design and composition, he submitted only a circle drawn freehand, the famous O of Giotto. Yet he was awarded the commission. Why? What's so impressive about a simple circle? Give a young child a crayon and paper and observe what he draws. At the earliest ages, children scrawl lines and zigzags. There comes a time when they discover that a line's end can meet its beginning, and they take the light in the loop. It continues endlessly around and creates an inside separate from an outside. Eventually, they come upon the circle. The circle brings the loop to perfection, so round in every direction. Children love to trace circular objects like cups and cans to achieve the fascinating perfection so hard for a young hand to draw. The discovery and appreciation of the circle is our early glimpse into the wholeness, unity, and divine order of the universe. Some psychologists say that the discovery of the circle arrives as the child discovers the self and distinguishes himself from another. Even as adults, our attention remains hypnotically drawn to circles, toward their centers, in objects we create, in those we see. We draw circles, and they draw us. Looking at a circle is like looking into a mirror. We create and respond irresistibly to circles, cylinders, and spheres because we recognize ourselves in them. The message of the shape bypasses our conscious mental circuitry and speaks directly to the quiet intelligence of our deepest being. The circle is a reflection of the world's and our own deep perfection, unity, design excellence, wholeness, and divine nature. To ancient mathematical philosophers, the circle symbolized the number one. They knew it as the source of all subsequent shapes, the womb in which all geometric patterns develop. The Greek term for the principles represented by the circle was monad, from the root menein, to be stable, and monas, or oneness. In the alphanumeric correspondences of the Greeks, the letters of the word monas add up to 361. The system allows a difference of one, so the word for oneness becomes 360. Not coincidentally, as that is also the number of degrees around a full circle. Ancient mathematical philosophers referred to the monad as the first, the seed, the essence, the builder, the foundation, the space producer, and, most dramatic, the immutable truth and destiny. It was also called Atlas because, like the Titan upholding the heavens it supports, it connects and separates the numbers it produces. The ancient philosophers conceived that the monad breathes in the void and creates all subsequent numbers. 111, 111, 111, times 111, 111, 111, equals 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Numbers only express different qualities of the monad. The ancients didn't consider unity to be a number, but rather a parent of numbers. They noted that unity exists in all things, yet remains in a parent. They saw the relation of the monad to all numbers in a metaphor of simple arithmetic. Any number, when multiplied by unity, remains itself. 3 times 1 equals 3. The same is true when unity divides into any number. 5 divided by 1 equals 5. Unity always preserves the identity of all it encounters. We might say that one waits quietly within each form without stirring, motionless, never mingling, yet supporting all. The monad is the universe's common denominator. The ancient Gnostics called it the silence force. The universe was carved of this primeval silence. Everything strives in one way or another toward unity. There's more to a circle than just a curved line. It's a wonderful first glyph of nature's alphabet. Every circle is identical. They only differ in size. Each circle you see or create is a profound statement about the transcendental nature of the universe. Expanding from the nowhere of its dimensionless center to the infinitely many points of its circumference, a circle implies the mysterious generation from nothing to everything. Its radius and circumference are never both measurable at the same time in similar units due to their mutual relation to the transcendental value known as pi equals 3.1415926. When neither the radius or circumference is measurable in whole rational units, the other is an endless irrational decimal. Thus, a circle represents the limited and unlimited in one body. In my end is my beginning. Motto of Mary, Queen of Scots, 1542-1587. Our deepest awareness, the power that motivates all awareness, which we can call the power to be conscious, of which we are not ordinarily cognizant, recognizes its own transcendental nature in the geometry of the circle. For this reason, the circle has been a universal symbol of an ideal perfection and divine state that always exists around and within us, whether we acknowledge it or not. Religious art has traditionally turned to the circle to symbolize this state of divinity as heaven, paradise, eternity, and enlightenment. It is unity that doth enchant me. Giordano Bruno, 1548-1600, Italian philosopher. Giotto's perfectly drawn circle communicated this universal ideal. Important tips on using the geometer's tools. Before we use the three classic tools of the geometer, here are some points you should consider. 1. These three tools, compass, straight edge, and pencil, are ancient, found in various forms in most cultures. Used by artists, architects, and craftspeople, they are both practical and symbolic. 2. Whether you use a metal compass or a string tied to a stick in the earth, these tools represent divine attributes. Treat them with respect. 3. Do nothing unconsciously. Be aware of each action you perform with them. No act in a geometric construction is trivial or without profound symbolism and correspondence to the world's creating process. 4. Don't erase mistakes. Just as we cannot undo life's missteps, leave all marks where you make them and live with them until you can do the construction differently. Line upon line, line upon line, here a little and there a little. Bible, Isaiah chapter 28, verse 10. Compass. The medieval geometers contemplated the compass as an abstract symbol of the eye of God. In their worldview, its legs represented rays of light and grace shining from heaven to earth, from deep within us outward toward the periphery of our ordinary awareness. The compass has only one role. From a central seed point, it creates the transcendental whole called the circle. It opens up a divine space of light, awareness, and potential configuration. Remember that every circle you construct represents the monad, the complete universe. When turning a circle, hold the compass at its top, not its legs, to avoid changing the size of the circle. Turn each circle in one complete rotation without hesitation, leaning the compass forward as you turn. Avoid drawing only arcs and partial circles in the constructions. Complete all circles to see the full pattern of forces. Straight edge. Where circles intersect, points are created. A straight edge allows us to rule lines between points, revealing paths of energy, motion, and force between them. Your straight edge needs no measure marks. measure is built into the performance of the geometry. The edge should be free of nicks. When drawing a line, put your pencil on one point and bring the straight edge against it, pivoting it to the second point. Then put the pencil on that second point to test its accuracy against the edge. Hold the straight edge firmly. Draw the line toward yourself in one steady stroke. Imagine the emerging line as a path of energy. Pencil. The scribe system, whether pencil and paper or stick and earth, is the means by which an archetypal pattern materializes. Pencil and paper translate divine, eternal ideas into symbols accessible to the geometer's sight. When you commit to creating a pencil stroke, move firmly, steadily, and deliberately, without hesitation. Keep the point sharp. Making a point. Creating one central point from which to radiate a circle is the beginning of all geometric construction, no matter how complex it becomes. The steps involved in any construction are a metaphor for the stages of the divine, ongoing creating process itself. Anywhere you place a center, you can scribe a circle and symbolically create the space of the universe itself. True thou art, lad, as the circumference to its center. Herman Melville, 1819 to 1891, American novelist. The circle is a shape begging to be organized. As the value one or unit is the parent of all numbers, the circle is the parent of all shapes. All subsequent shapes and patterns will be inscribed within this all-encompassing monad. That's why the world is called a universe, Latin for one turn. No other universes exist except within this one, which Plato refers to as the whole of wholes. The world is single, and it came into being from the center outwards. Johann Stobaeus, 5th century AD, Greek anthologist. To construct a symbolic universe, begin with a point, the circle's essence. Hold the closed compass upright and poke a symbolic point upon the paper. A true point is impossible to draw, having absolutely no dimension, not length, width, or height. Ours is not a true mathematical point, because seen under the microscope, it's a three-dimensional heap of carbon. Ideal geometry is impossible to perform with human tools. We can only symbolize ideals by the geometric shapes we construct. The closed upright compass on the point represents the mythological world axis, world mountain, or holy center of many cultures, the symbolic pole or spine that supports creation and around which everything turns in adoration. Traditionally, the center is the most honorable place, known to the Greeks as the keep of Zeus. Protector of hearths and boundaries, centers and circumferences, and the source of moral order, Zeus dispensed judgment from the center. God makes himself known to the world. He fills up the whole circle of the universe, but makes his particular abode in the center, which is the soul of the just. Lucian, circa 240 to 312, Christian theologian. Nothing exists without a center around which it revolves, whether the nucleus of an atom, the heart of our body, hearth of the home, capital of a nation, sun in the solar system, or black hole at the core of a galaxy. When the center does not hold, the entire affair collapses. An idea or conversation is considered pointless, not because it leads nowhere, but because it has no center holding it together. The point is the source of our whole of wholes. It is beyond understanding, unknowable, silently self-enfolded. But like a seed, a point will expand to fulfill itself as a circle. geometric construction can be used as a form of meditation. Ponder the point as a seed enfolding a sacred mystery. Hold that sense of wonder through the full construction. We can use this approach to symbolic geometry as sacred geometry by experiencing what the construction process symbolizes within us. We can do this by shifting attention from outside to inside, from the page to its viewer. Consider the point as symbolizing your own center. What center? Dancers and gymnasts gracefully work with the body center of gravity to balance during motion. Undersea divers walk around at the bottom wearing a 20-pound weight at their groin, the center of gravity. Even when sitting motionless, everyone has a psychological center of gravity, the thoughts, emotions, or desires with which we identify and from which we view the world at any given moment. Through meditation and self-contemplation, we can seek a more subtle center, our higher or deeper self, the power that motivates the actions, emotions, thoughts, and desires. This center of gravity is not in space, but in pure awareness, the place in you now aware of these very words. Where do you hear
these words? We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.